Good morning to all. Good morning to all of you. As I said at the prayer breakfast, that was just a really fun night last night, and the energy on the campus and up in the gym was great. I had a fantastic time watching and taking part in some of those activities, though I did discover that my badminton game is not very good. But thank you for all who helped make that so fun and so special. And today, we obviously what we do today is celebrate a hero, but it's a lot more than that, I think. And I think of, when I think of Martin Luther King myself, and obviously I'm older than most of you in the room, you know, when our heroes are often who our parents' heroes are, right? You often talk to your parents about who they respect and who their heroes were and are. And for me, the child of two college professors who really, I think, cared about politics and cared about civil rights, I remember talking to them as a boy. And I remember images of King and civil rights. Those images came on a little tiny TV set. And there are some of the older folks in the back of the room who would recognize this. It's this little tiny black and white TV. You could barely get a picture. You had to actually reach and grab the antenna and kind of adjust things. And sometimes you'd wrap tin foil around that antenna to make one of the, whatever, five total channels come in. And those were where I came across some of those images. And I remember sitting hunched around that tiny TV. It's where we saw the first moon landing. It's where every Saturday I'd watch a show called Wide World of Sports. And it was also where I remember those images of the civil rights. And because he was a hero of my parents, I think Martin Luther King became a hero of mine. And why wouldn't he? Just one of the single most important leaders in this nation's history. And I think a great patriot and a great thinker and a great tactician and a really inspiring speaker. But I think as much as we obviously are celebrating him, I would also say we're celebrating ourselves. And that sounds really selfish, but we should. And it's a really good feeling to celebrate ourselves and celebrate the community. And I think it means two things. When I look on this campus, there is a richness, there's a diversity of experience and nationality and gender, sexual orientation, politics, ethnicity, race, and that's vital to the success of this place. And it never would have happened. None of this happens without the kind of thinking that Martin Luther King, I think, tried to trumpet. A community, I have a really simple belief here as an educator. A diverse community is a lot more interesting to learn at than a homogenous one. Can you imagine a classroom where there was no disagreement, where you had no divergent views, where people didn't challenge you? So the first principle is a really simple one, that we try to be a diverse place, not because it's a politically correct term, but because if you want to learn and be challenged, you want to be in a room of smart people who do not view the world the way you do. And the second reason we do this is, and the second reason we should celebrate who we are and the diversity on this campus is, we need to provide students with rehearsal in existing in a world in which only those who can collaborate with and work with people who view the world differently, only those will succeed. If you do not develop that habit here, if you do not develop that appetite, that practice in collaborating with and becoming teammates with, and being challenged by people who look at the world differently than you, then you will miss the train to progress, and that is absolutely clear. And so we should celebrate difference. We should be excited about it. You should be proud of it. And every single person in this room is part of it, every single one of us. And so that's what this day is about. It's about celebrating the fact that this is a diverse school where we want to make each other better, and I think ultimately we become better world citizens because of that. So I hope today is a wonderful day. I love this day, and I particularly love the afternoon when we get back in here. And with that, I want to introduce, obviously, the two school head bonds. And so if Vienna and then Quentin would come forward, and they will offer some remarks to get us started. So I think, Vienna, are you up first? Please, welcome Vienna.
Good morning. This year's image for Martin Luther King Day is a patchwork of students' faces arranged to make up the face of Dr. King, and it's especially appropriate for our community. Our annual celebration of Dr. King reflects our community's appreciation for progress, unity, and for one another. The celebration of World Fest last night is an example of each of our individual ability to appreciate the unique community and culture of those around us. Dr. King once said, "We all have the drum major instinct. We all want to be important, to surpass others, and to achieve distinction. The great issue of life is to harness the drum major instinct. It is a good instinct if you don't distort it and pervert it. Don't give it up. Keep feeling the need for being important. Keep feeling the need for being first. But I want you to be the first in love. I want you to be the first in moral excellence. I want you to be the first in generosity. Taft teaches all of us to achieve distinction. But our celebration of Martin Luther King Day reflects our corresponding goal, to be the first in love and moral excellence. World Fest is a statement that what makes each Taft student unique is also what makes them important, and is in turn what brings all of us closer together as a community. Individually, we are all motivated and hardworking, but together we make up a patchwork of acceptance and of appreciation. This year's theme of celebrating diversity and embracing inclusivity is very accessible for our community. It presents us with a distinctly tangible goal, to explore and explicitly state the gratitude we feel for one another every day. The words of the song We Are the World, which was so beautifully brought to life this morning by gospel choir at the prayer breakfast, reminds each one of us of our potential. To quote the song, we are the ones who make a brighter day, let's start giving. There's a choice we're making, and we are saving our own lives. In your workshop this morning, each one of you is capitalizing on your ability to make a brighter day. As a community, we are making the choice to save our own lives by educating ourselves. Approach each workshop with an open mind and a willingness to discover. Even if we don't learn something new, we are still taking advantage of one another's valuable presence. King stated, life's most persistent and urgent question is, what are you doing for others? This morning, we have the opportunity to do something for one another as well as for ourselves. Exercise your ability to be the first in love, generosity, and moral excellence. We're going to have an amazing day. Thank you.
Oftentimes, it is easy to overlook the vast diversity we are fortunate to experience here at Taft. With representation of over 30 countries and 30 states, we truly do have a unique and diverse community filled with individuals that share different thoughts, opinions, and cultures, which ultimately enhances the overall experience for everyone in the community. Taft is a community that prides itself on establishing a varied and accepting community that celebrates and embraces the diversity within the community, as seen by last night's festivities at WorldFest. I believe that in order to establish and maintain this kind of community, each and every member has to strive on becoming an informed and involved citizen, much like Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. embodied the characteristics of an informed and involved citizen, speaking out courageously for what he believed in during a remarkable period in the history of our nation. I want to share a brief excerpt from MLK's letter from a Birmingham jail written April 12, 1963, while King was in jail in Birmingham after being arrested for participating in a sit-in demonstration protesting against public eating facilities. The letter was written to his fellow clergymen who were critical of him for coming to Birmingham from Atlanta to participate in the demonstration. King writes, I am cognizant of the interrelatedness of all communities and states. I cannot sit idly by in Atlanta and not be concerned about what happens in Birmingham. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. As we embark on a day filled with learning and remembrance, I urge you to think about how you can strive to be a more informed and involved citizen, both at Taft and in the national and world communities, just as Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. did during his lifetime. Thank you.
I want to introduce some remarkable students, both on this campus and from Waterbury, and let me explain what that's about. It's not news to you, obviously, that the school has a deep commitment of community service. It's our motto, and it goes back really throughout our history. But one place in which I think we're doing some really remarkable work is the ways in which we're partnering with Waterbury. And in some ways, this is an extension of work that has been going on for a long time, in particular in the recent decades by Baba Fru, who has done so much in leading our community service efforts in Waterbury. And then Laura Monty and Jeremy Clifford, who have been doing work in terms of tutoring in the summer. And all of this is being pulled together and spearheaded by Jamela Lee. And I think this is one of the most exciting things that's happened on the Taft campus in many years. We are developing a partnership with the leaders in Waterbury, both educational leaders and municipal leaders, particularly in the police department, with the goal of creating what we've called a Global Leadership Institute. And you've heard about this, and it is both profoundly complicated and really simple. The simple part is the mission. And the mission is to see if we can partner a great city and a great school in developing future leaders who will develop the skills and the habits to take on the thorniest problems that the world faces, and to somehow see if they can, in the future, become the leaders who help solve those problems. And you do that by collaborating. You do that by recognizing that when you put the wisdom of crowds at work, when you put really smart people in a room together, people with a kind of deep, powerful ethical system and a lot of intelligence, that you can then make great leaders for the future. And so we are this year launching the Global Leadership Institute, and I want to introduce the people who will take part in it and also the leaders. And I'd like to introduce the Chief Academic Officer, Anne-Marie Cullinan, who is with us today. She is the woman who is leading the curricular efforts in the entire city of Waterbury. She's a fascinating curricular leader, and I'd like to ask her to come forward, and then we're going to introduce the students. So could you please welcome the Chief Academic Officer, Anne-Marie Cullinan. I'm going to have them doing you there, right. In order to create the Institute, we set out and worked with Anne-Marie and Ms. Lee and did a really tough application process. Students in Waterbury and at Taft were invited to submit applications and essays indicating why they wanted to take part in this inaugural efforts of the Global Leadership Institute. They had to reflect on their own leadership style. They had to reflect on what they would contribute in a year-long process, which would involve outside speakers, writing essays, doing readings, and working together to develop these skills. And what I'd like to do is ask those students to come forward, and we're going to recognize them up front. I will start with the 10 students from Taft. Again, if you would please come forward, you can welcome Anne-Marie and then stand here. We'll applaud them at the end. And representing Taft in the Global Leadership Institute are Sunny An, Sasha Alvarez, Lauren Fadiman, Jennifer Gian, Ziggy Javaltis, Marissa Mission, Nick Morgosia, Eliza Price, Kovaya Selva, and Justa Cinema Kate. Please come forward. If they would, we recognize them. And I would like to welcome, and with a particular pride and excitement, those students who are going to be joining the Institute from Waterbury, who went through the exact same process. It was enormously competitive. There were scores of students who wanted to partake in this. And I really look forward to getting to know all of you. So would you please welcome, give their names, Fiza Alam from Waterbury Career Academy, Gina DeVito from Waterbury Arts Magnet School, Brennan Engelhardt from Waterbury Arts Magnet, Mohamed Mashour from Crosby High School, Christian Milan from Kennedy High, Julia Nagayan from Wilby High, Jade Roman from Kennedy High, Selena Soto from Waterbury Career Academy, Vald Vilfort from Wilby High, and Justin Welch from Kennedy High School. Let's recognize all of these. Well done. This is a really great honor. It's a great honor for all the students. It was, as I said, a very competitive process, and I'm particularly delighted. I think the vision of leading scholars in Waterbury and leading scholars at Taft standing together, I really believe that we're going to look back on this one day, and Anne-Marie, I know you share this. We will look back on this one day and say something special started in this great city and this great school. So congratulations to all of you. Welcome to Taft, all of you wonderful visitors. And I will close, and we will move to a video, I think, so if we could have the screen come down. Congratulations.
I was born blind, mentally retarded. And then as I grew older, of course, my mother had other kids, and she knew right there that something was wrong because they were progressing, they were walking and talking and everything.
When Loretta Claiborne was four, she was still unable to walk, and her mother turned to state doctors. They told her Loretta belonged in an institution. Her mother refused, opting for this special education classroom in their hometown of York, Pennsylvania. But for Loretta, school was more of a punishment than a liberation.
I guess she had been told for 4 or 5 years that she could do nothing, that she was nothing.
That's just what she was doing, nothing.
I used to go in my room and just cry.
She still was not walking very well.
Just cry because kids were teasing.
She had become this whole locale's target.
More or less rejected.
She was made the butt of many jokes.
Somebody called me bozo.
Crossed eyes.
Cross-eyed Clarence, a cross-eyed lion or something like that.
She wouldn't make eye contact.
I would just stand in the corner.
And stand with her face to the wall.
So I couldn't fight them back. Tore my heart out. It really hurts.
The only thing you would do is cry. In order to avoid the harassment, before the bell rang, 5 minutes before the bell rang, I would open the back door and say, Loretta, run.
Loretta spent her childhood running these streets, running through the projects from the things that tormented her. But somewhere on these same streets, she stopped running to get away and started running to get ahead.
I started running more, and I learned to, just by overcoming it, just by running, and people would say, that girl could run.
She finished the 1981 Boston Marathon in just over 3 hours, placing her in the top 100 women overall. Today, her marathon count is 26.
I think running has meant a lot to Loretta because it's given her a sense of self-accomplishment. And with that self-accomplishment, the next hurdle isn't as large, and it's not a barrier that she can't get through, but she knows she's already cleared one, and what's another? You know, what's another? What's another?
Walk up the table! Go! Answer!
She bowls competitively and has earned a 4th-degree black belt in karate. Now she is learning to swim. The sign language she is using is one of the 4 languages she has taught herself, among them Russian and Arabic.
I was just a little slow at learning it, but I kept on knocking at it and knocking at it and knocking at it. When they were resting, I was still working at it.
She could have done all of this without ever leaving her hometown. But in 1970, she was introduced to Special Olympics, and Special Olympics introduced Loretta to the world.
My dreams would come true. Every Special Olympic race I've ever won made me want to be in the running for everything else in life.
She has grown enormously in the last 10 years. Who would have predicted that Loretta, at the end of a 10-year, would be chosen to introduce the President of the United States?
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States of America, Bill Clinton.
She has won 4 gold medals in 4 different events. She was named Special Olympics Athlete of the Year in 1990 and Athlete of the Quarter Century by Runner's World magazine. But she is not satisfied. She is training for 1997 in yet another sport.
She doesn't recognize her courage. She doesn't know that what she's done with her life has taken so much guts.
Ain't nothing special about me. Ain't nothing. You know, there's people out there who run better than I can. There's people out there who swim better than I can. There's people out there who bowl better than I can. I don't have a lot of money. I live with a budget. I live in a small, tiny apartment. But I'm happy. I'm happy.
Good morning. I have been on the board for Special Olympics, so happen to have the very, very great pleasure to be able to introduce the person you just saw. I don't need to tell you about her accolades, but I do want to say one thing. A quote from Loretta: "I figured if my story could change a person's mind about another person, or especially a child's mind about another child, then it was the right thing to do." Please give Loretta Claiborne our welcome, Taft. Hello. Thank you.
Wondering if my thing was working. I'm sorry, behind the mic. You noticed I'm using sign language. It was something I was told I wouldn't be able to do. I'm going to tell you a little bit about what I thought of the school when I passed by and when I had the offer to speak here. I had a different impression of Taft. You know, we live in a society of assumption. And I thought I would see young people dressed up in suits. That's why I wore the jacket. I was expecting the students to be all uniformed, because you're supposed to be evidently from all over the world and well established. Well, see, what you see when you don't see beyond your nose is different. So I'm hoping that we all learn to look beyond our nose and look wide, because the picture is bigger when you're looking out farther. And my assumption was wrong. And it was the same way for Martin Luther King. It was the same way for my mother. In fact, I remember my mother telling me her stories. She couldn't go to the same fountain. And in fact, when she went to school, she went to an all-black school. And I remember one time after school, after our school, school had ended that year, and we were playing out in the porch with all the materials that we had for the whole year. And of course, my sister Stella, I'm the teacher. So now we're going to say the national anthem. Oh, bossy Stella. We have one of them in every family. Now we're going to say the national anthem. Everybody stand up and start singing. And my mother turned around and said, "Let me tell you something, Stella. That's not the anthem I learned. I had to learn that anthem in one night." And we all turned around and looked. "Well, what did you learn?" She said, "We learned the Negro anthem, lift every voice and sing." And it kind of took us back. And my mother actually wanted us to learn that particular anthem that she had learned. But of course, my anthem is the same anthem that you follow. So I actually had two anthems. Just a little note of expecting the unexpected. Just like I expected everyone to be in an outfit here and a uniform. Well, I'm going to take you back in my story. We say celebrating diversity and embracing inclusivity. Well, when I think about that, I think about the exclusion that I had in my life. And my little saying is, Special Olympics is about including instead of excluding. And when you came up with a child like me, yes, like the basketball player, some of you didn't get to hear him speak, Mr. Archibald, said he grew up in the project. But he grew up with two parents. And he had the supports of two parents. Well, my mother was one. And she had nine children, really, in reality. But she raised seven by herself. The other two didn't make it into this world. And one of those seven children was differently abled. Now we say a person with intellectual disability. The film was dated, and you notice they use a word that I don't like to use today, born with mental retardation, but that was the time. And that was the sign of that time. But the sign of the time today is much different. And as I came along, I remember my mom telling me, "Oh, Loretta, when you were born, you were a big, bouncy baby, big old baby, probably one of the biggest babies born in the hospital at the time, almost 13 pounds. born blind, couldn't see. But my mother was a strong, big woman herself. I bet she weighed every bit over 300 pounds, but at the time when I was born, she wasn't that big. Of course, I was born in stair steps. It was Alan, Hank. It was Hank, Alan, Debbie, then me, then Stella. Then it was one that didn't make it, Marlena, Van. And then there was my sister, Violet, that didn't make it. And years later, we adopted Lisa. And my mom would tell me. Well, the first year of school, I was held back. First year was kindergarten. Second year was first grade, I was held back. Third time was second grade, I was held back. So I was a pretty big kid in second grade. And you know what happens to the big kid in second grade? At that time, they were called the dummy. And they became the punching bag. And it wasn't fun. Got ridiculed, got called names. And yes, I rebelled. I had two good weapons on me. And it was these things called fists. And I knew how to use them very well. Oh, and by the way, I have a 4th-degree black belt. For real. I have a 4th-degree black belt in Ishinru Karate. 28 years of martial arts. I used to teach martial arts. But back at that time, I had just two fists to defend myself. Because of the names I got called. Because of being punched. My mom did not condone me to fight. She sent me to school to learn. And when you're a child with an intellectual disability in a segregated class, no, not drinking out of a different water fountain like my mother did, no, not going to an all-black school like my mother did, or being in that project where there were thousands of other kids, you didn't have no chance just to defend yourself. And I got called names. And I tell you what, the worst thing somebody can call you, you think it's funny. And some of you, I hope you take this seriously. You're young. You're very young. The names that you're called when you're this high will live with you the rest of your life. Who's a football player here? Ooh, I like the big guy right down there in the plaid shirt. Sir? Can I ask you something? Could you be a volunteer? Could you come up here on the stage? I gotta ask you some questions first. Come over here, I'm not gonna bite you. I'm not a dog, I'm not a cat, and I'm gonna scratch you. You're a pretty big gentleman. First of all, I'm going to ask you some questions, because I don't want that lawyer out there to sue me. Do you have any kind of health issues? Do you bruise easily?
No.
No. So you play football. You're pretty strong.
Kind of.
Kind of? What's your hand that you eat with and write with?
Left.
You're left-handed. So I want you to take that left hand, that strong hand, and leave it open. Now I want you to take that weak hand and I want you to put it out here in the fist and tighten it up. Not hard enough. Feel this. Okay, now I want you to take this hand out. Now I'm a 4th-degree black belt, but you know what? You're gonna do the demonstration on yourself. I want you to take that flat hand, I want you to tighten this up, and I want you to give that a big fat smack. Hard. Come on, you can do better than that. That stings, doesn't it?
A little bit.
Try it again. Stings, doesn't it?
A little bit.
Now, I had him do this demonstration because he knows it stings. Within a minute or two, that sting will be gone. Within 2 years or a year from now, he might still remember this demonstration. But the whole point of this demonstration is, there's an old saying, sticks and stones may break my bones, but names will never hurt. That sting might sting him a little bit, but the names that people call people hurt, the R word for those with intellectual disabilities, started out with mental retardation, a good term, a medical term, but it got sliced, and they see retard. All of you, I bet you if I take 10 students across this row, four of you would know somebody or have somebody in your family who has an intellectual disability. The whole pretense of this demonstration with sticks and stones may break my bones, but names will never hurt is a total lie. Those names you will carry with you forever. Whether you're from the other side of the track, whether you're not the richest kid in this school, or maybe whether you're the brightest kid in this school and you get teased. Oh yes, they're very intelligent. Thank you, sir. The very intelligent run through the same thing. I was told I wouldn't be able to go to school. Yes, I went to school, I was held back. I was told I wasn't going to graduate from school. My mom's dream was for me to graduate from high school. But the society, the system of York City School District came to her and said, "Ms. Claiborne, I know you got six kids, seven kids, this one's not going to go to school." But she fought. She was the Martin Luther King for me to have my rights to go to school. You're going to have to fight if you want to be the person that you choose to be. No matter where you go in life, you're going to have a struggle. I struggle every day to be the best that I can be. But I do not let nothing stop me from where I want to go or who I am. And as time went by, my mother still fought for me to graduate. Still, I had in my mind, I wanted to be a nurse. I knew it wasn't going to happen. I wanted to be a veterinarian. I knew it wasn't going to happen. And I wanted to be an athlete. And I didn't think it was going to happen. It was during a time in school when they started a program called School to Work, where they take the kids from the special education department and send them off to a shelter workshop. And I met a counselor there. And that counselor said to me, "Loretta, you are so angry. If you learn how to put those hands down and use those feet more, maybe you can go places in life." I didn't understand them because I was still rebellious. No, I didn't go to jail like Martin Luther King. Instead, for me, they pumped me up with medicine to keep me quiet. And even that wasn't working. Then the right pill came when a gentleman by the name of Lee Gilreath says, "Loretta, I see you running every day from the shelter workshop to home." And I look at him in anger. I didn't speak. Not that I couldn't speak. I could speak very well, but what was the point? Nobody wanted me. Nobody in my community wanted me. "Oh, that's the dumb kid. Hey, that's the retard. Why should I speak? Only thing she could do is fight. Stay away from her." Only time I would be included in the game when it involved running or fighting. But this man saw something when he saw me come to that workshop. He called me on the office phone across the loudspeaker and says, "Can Miss Claiborne please come to my office?" And my co-workers actually looked and says, "Huh, man. Maybe she's getting thrown out here. Huh, she took a screwdriver and threw it at somebody. Huh, maybe the crazy one is gone." I went to the office and they gave me a paper and I could barely read it. And the only word I could read was Olympics by watching that little tiny TV like the gentleman said up here and seeing the Olympics every 4 years. That was the time I settled. And I was in my own zone to watch the world's fastest runners, to watch the world's fastest skiers or skaters or swimmers, not thinking that it was only a dream to me, Would it become a reality? That piece of paper that man gave me, I took it home and I set it down on the table. My mom says, what's this? She was playing card. She says, Special Olympics. I ain't got nothing for my retarded child. That's the term they used at that time. She threw the paper up. She said, huh, that's money on my welfare check. I got two children in drum corps. Neighbor looked at her and said, Miss Claiborne, you have two children in drum corps, it's true. And the third one going, why don't you let Loretta have something? Maybe this is better than all those pills she'd taken. Time went by. It was the best thing that ever happened to me. That was in 1970. Today, I still compete. I started running in 1966. If the good Lord is willing and keeps me with my strength, next year I'll be running 50 years. I started running with my brother Hank, who's now deceased. Those of you who saw the movie, The Loretta Claiborne Story, I think Mrs. Mason here will have a copy for your school. It's the Hollywood version of my life. But most of the fact is true. And no, I didn't live in that cutesy house that they show in the movie. We lived in projects where whose roaches was whose roaches. And we'd turn around, my mom says, you go up there and you keep them roaches up there, Miss So-and-so. I ain't got no roaches down here. My five girls is in there doing my dishes, taking care of my house. Don't you let near one of your roaches come here. And we knew what it was to be hungry. Sometimes I sit and I tell Mrs. Mason and her kids when they get out of hand and they think that they have everything. I said, little man, you don't know what it is. I said, because if I would have pulled a step what you just did, I'd have been wearing a brand new backside. And he would say, I would say abuse. And I said, and you would be getting it cut again. My dreams finally became a reality. I became an athlete. It didn't cost my mother one penny. My life started to change. I didn't have to go through the troubles of what my mother went through, but I had my own troubles. And when you're excluded from society, when you're excluded from class, when you're excluded from a circle, when you're excluded from anything in life, and young people, you might be, just because of the stature you're going to task school. You might be excluded in adulthood. It still happens every day, no matter whether you're black, yellow, pink, use a wheelchair, gay, you'll be excluded. But I always say, don't let nobody stop you from where you want to go or where you want to do. I always look at myself when somebody's trying to push me out, I say I'm like a weed. You cut me down, you run away for a week, I'm back up in your face. I'm like that old penny. It just keeps turning up. And that's the philosophy I use today. Special Olympics has opened not only my body, it's turned me around because they said, you're going to be heavy just like your mother. My mom was a big, broad woman, 380 pounds. But I tell you what, nothing stopped her. And I was determined that I wasn't going to be 380 pounds, that I wasn't going to have diabetes at the age of 34, that I wasn't going to have blood pressure at the age of 40. And if God willing, in 2 years, I'll probably outlive my mother. She struggled, but she was a good mother. Martin Luther King struggled, but he was a good man. He was for all people. He always says, let me do what's right, not for myself, but for others. Eunice Kennedy Shriver, when she created Special Olympics, the same year that Martin Luther King and her brother was killed in 1968, I remember it like it was yesterday. Like it was yesterday when Martin Luther King got killed. And I ran down the hill, I was looking at the TV with my Uncle Herb, who had one arm, who could make a bed so tight, he could take and make the bed with one arm and take a coin and bounce it and catch it. I seen him do it too many times. And I ran down the hill to my mom. My mom was a big woman watching TV. She was watching something else. I flew open the door and said, Rena, guess what? Dr. Martin Luther King died. And my sister jumped up and says, Black Power! And my mom said to my sister, you sit your behind down. Loretta was right. She said he was for all people. That's the first time I had a voice in my house that I was right. That was the first time that I was told I was right in my home. An argument over something so simple, but yet so complex. He was for all people. Eunice Kennedy Shriver, when she created Special Olympics, she wanted to show society that people with intellectual disability can do things with the right supports. And today, when I look at Special Olympics, it has grown so big. Not only in athletes, not only in countries, 170 countries and counted will come to LA this summer. 4.5 million athletes, including people like you, who are intellectually bright, competing on the same team with people who is not as bright. But when you're on the playing field, it's how fast you shoot the ball or roll the ball or hit the ball or run. It's called unified sports, bringing people together. Inclusiveness, diversity. Diversity is not just the color of a skin or a religion. Diversity is bringing all together. It's like making minestrone soup. You have everything in it, including the very bright and those who are not as bright. To me, Eunice Kennedy Shriver created Special Olympics. And when I look at Special Olympics today with unified sports and bringing people together, so far as you people here at Taft, you young people, thank you so much for letting the people of Waterbury, Special Olympic athletes, come in and be a part of your school. You are fulfilling Martin Luther King's dream. My dream is now a reality because you give. There's an old saying Bob Marley says, live for yourself, you'll live in vain. Live for others, you'll live again. But in the kingdom of Jah, which means God, you shall reign. So I want you to pass it on. Pass on Martin Luther King. Pass on Mrs. Shriver. Celebrate yourself, but celebrate more when you do something for somebody else. Thank you so much. Now I'm going to open up. I'm going to ask your staff, our headmasters here, do I have time enough for a couple questions and answers?
Yes, a couple of minutes, and we have one last performance.
Yes. I'm going to have two or three questions. Does anyone have a question? Maybe from the middle section here? Use your outside voice, yes.
What was your favorite sport that you got to participate in?
My favorite sport that I got to participate in was the one I started at the age of 12, was running. Because it's cheap and it doesn't cost nothing but a pair of decent shoes. It gives me time to think instead of using these. Like the coach told me, use these more. You can go places instead of using this. Yes?
You said you taught yourself, I think, three different languages. How did you teach yourself then?
I used the cassette tape. And I just listened over and over. I want to relearn Spanish, because when I was like 15 years old, language is like anything else. If you don't use it, you lose it. So I lost a lot of my Spanish. But I can understand more than I speak, so I want to relearn Spanish, because it's becoming sort of like a prominent language in our country. And yes, I know sign language. I'll never forget that language at all. Anyone else? One more question, yes.
Did you enjoy learning how to figure skate?
I do enjoy figure skating. I still do, believe it or not. I'm 61 years old, and I'm going to be skating in competition. And to me, sport doesn't end in high school. Sport is lifelong. That's why I want to combat the obesity. One more question. Someone up in the gallery here. Go ahead.
You said you were born blind.
Yes.
I
had to have surgery. I had something like a cataract over my eyes. So they had removed them at the age of 4. And then in 1969, I had to have surgery again to straighten out my eyes so that people wouldn't call me names. I still today only look with one eye at a time. So if I'm looking at you, sir, I'm looking at you sitting like this, and the other lady over here sitting like this. So I'm good in basketball, but I have a close eye and a far eye. One more question? Yes, way in the back.
What is the next thing on your agenda?
Well, the next thing on my agenda, I just taking things by stride. I was hoping to make the World Games in 2015. I did not make it, but my goal was to make that team. Of course, they had to make it fair by picking out of a lottery. But if I would have made that team, it would have been 43 years since I competed in 1972. To come back and compete at a world-class level 43 years later, that's rarely said or done. But I just gotten done. I was at the White House back in July on the 31st with the President of the United States, and I had dinner with him at his table. So that was like the 8th time I was at the White House. One more. Last question.
Is there any athlete
that influenced
you the most?
Is there any athlete that influenced me the most? There are some athletes that influenced me the most, and one of them was Wilma Rudolph. She was always told that she would not be a Tennessee Belle to run for Tennessee State, and she was also told because of her disability that she wouldn't be able to run. And at the time, she became the fastest woman in the world. Look her up on the website. So now I'm going to break because they said there is another performance. Thank you so much, the students of Taft. And remember to keep your dream alive. Thank you.
What's wrong with the world, mama? People living like they ain't got no mamas. I think the whole world's thinking to the drama. Only attracted by things that bring the trauma. Overseas, yeah, we're trying to stop terrorism. But we still got terrorists here living. In the USA, the big CIA. The Bloods and the Crips and the KKK. But if you only have love for your own race, then you only leave space to discriminate. And to discriminate only generates hate. And when you hate, then you're bound to get irate. Yeah, man, this is what you demonstrate. And that's the only way anger works and operates. Man, you gotta have love that'll set it straight. Take control of your mind and meditate. Like your soul gravitate to the love, y'all.
Killing people, dying. Children hurting, healing, crying. Would you practice what you preach? Would you turn the other cheek? Call the Father, Father, help us. Send some guidance from above. People got me questioning. Where is the love?
Just ain't the same, old ways of change. New days are strange, is the world insane? If love and peace is so strong, why the nations of love that don't belong? Nations dropping bombs, chemical gas, and filling loads of little ones with ongoing suffering as the youth that young. So ask yourself, is the loving really gone? So I can ask myself, what is really going wrong with the world that we live in? People keep on giving it, making wrong decisions, only visions of them giving. There's not
each other, denying thy brother. A war is going on, but the reason double cover. The truth is kept secret, swept under the rug. If you never know truth, then you never know love. Where's the love?